Happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Oh, happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Our trust is in you. Our trust is in you. Our trust is in you, Lord. Oh, happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. All our trust is in you, Father. All our trust is in you, Lord. All our trust is in you, Father. All our trust is in you. Set my feet a dancing. You fill my heart with joy. Oh, you set my feet a dancing. You fill my heart with joy. Oh, you love. Oh, you set my feet a dancing. You fill my heart with joy. You set my soul with more of you. Floods of joy, filling my soul. Filling my soul with more of you. Floods of joy, filling my soul. Filling my soul with more of you. Oh, fill me with more and more and more and more and more and more of you. Fill me with more and more and more and more of you. Fill with more and more and more of you. More of you. Oh, fill with more of you. Fill with more of you, Lord. More of you, Lord. Oh, fill with more of you. Fill with more of you, oh Lord.
Fill with more of you.
For you set my feet to dance. You fill my heart with joy. For you set my feet to dance.
Jesus, we worship you. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you breathe upon us. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you fill us to overflowing. That you lead us and you guide us into all truth. Father, you reveal the Son in us. Oh, hallelujah. Lord Jesus, right now as a body, we pray for the meetings that are going on in India. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Father, for the glory of heaven shaking all of India. Awakening. Awakening to India. Awakening to India, Father. In Jesus' name. Awaken India, Father. Awaken them. Awaken them, O God. Father, let your word go forth and set the captive free. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, for great miracles, signs, and wonders, the proof provider, showing up and showing forth your glory, Father, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you that every country that Pastor Mark sets his foot in, there's great awakening. Father, let your glory cover this earth again as the waters cover the sea. Let your glory again cover this earth as the waters cover the sea. Father, this earth is in dire need of a move of your Holy Spirit. And I thank you, Father, that you're raising up your people all over the world and all over this nation, Father God, that will not stand for mediocrity anymore. But Father God will run after you. Father, I thank you that you're raising up people in this place, Father God, that are good soldiers in your kingdom, that are good soldiers, Father God, and they'll turn the armies of the enemy to flight and will not back down, but will see your glory cover this earth as the water covers the sea. Thank you, Jesus, that we will stand in the gap. We will be repairers of the breach, restorers of the past to dwell in. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Father. Glory to your name, Jesus. Glory to your name, Jesus. Oh, I tell you. There is a need of a great awakening in the earth today. And it's amazing how God has chosen us to be those that will bring the awakening. Thank you, Jesus. All we have to do is realize what he's already done and get up and run with what he's given us. Hallelujah. I tell you what, San Diego needs to be shaken with the power of God. And as we receive, that's the key, us receiving what he's done and us receiving his love, us coming to understand and comprehend his goodness. Oh, his goodness. Oh, his goodness. Oh, his great love for us. I am never going to get over that he's loved us with an everlasting love. I'm never getting over that. I'm just going to take a hold of it and be partaker of it. He's loved us with an everlasting love, and he draws us with his loving kindness. That is amazing. That God, the creator of all things, loved us so much that he loves us that much. He loves us so much. This is hilarious. One side sits down, the other side sits down. Oh, God. Oh, your love. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Father. Your love. Thank you, Father. You know, the Lord just, he put this on my heart, and I'm going to just share this real quick. I have not recovered from this morning, and I don't ever want to recover. I just want to go from glory to glory. Jesus. Oh, he's just so good. Everything I look at in his word is just amazing. Everything that I see in him is amazing. I'm captivated by his love. I'm raptured over into his glory, and I'm so in love with him. I'm so in love with him because he first loved me. I mean, just comprehending that. And it's so true. In the middle of all the mess, God loves us. Oh, Father. But you know, I just want to share with you real quick in Judges. I don't know what the Lord's going to do. I just want him to do it. Whew. But, Jesus. In Judges chapter 2, and I'm going to just start in verse 1. And the angel of the Lord came up from Gilgal to Bochim and said, I made you go up out of Egypt, and I brought you up into the land which I swore to your fathers. And I said, I will never break covenant with you. He said, I will never leave you or forsake you. I will never leave you or forsake you. I'll never break covenant. God never breaks covenant, people. He never breaks covenant. He's there. The only trouble we get ourselves into is if we break covenant. But, you know, looking at this, and he said, he told him, he said, you shall make no league with the inhabitants of the land, and you shall throw down their altars, but you've not obeyed my voice. Why have you done this? You've not obeyed my voice. Why have you done this? When God sent the children of Israel into the promised land, his chosen people that he brought up out of Israel, he said, completely wipe it out. I will go before you and I will drive them out. I'll send hornets. You know, he used the smallness, just the little things that Israel had to offer to subdue great nations. Israel was not a great or a mighty people, and God said, I didn't choose you because you were great or mighty. I chose you because I love you and I have a covenant with your fathers. With your father Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I made a covenant with them because they followed wholly after me. I didn't choose you because you were great. But then he went before them and he did everything for them basically. Yes, they had to get up and do something and join in with him and be obedient. But when they got into Israel, they got into the promised land. You can read again and again, but they did not completely drive them out. I kept looking at that, but they did not completely drive them out. And God promised to be with them. But again, there must have, it doesn't expound on that, but there must have been, again, situations where they looked like the 10 spies did and said, we can't do it. And they didn't completely drive them out. So the Lord said, why did you do this? I've made an everlasting covenant with you. But because you didn't completely fulfill your part of it, I was going to send the hornets. All you had to do is go up and take possession. You know, Father wants us to completely take possession of everything he's done for us. But he says, now I'm not going to drive them out. They're going to be a thorn in your side. And for good for you. Because they're going to be there to try you to see if you'll serve me and love me. You know, and after Joshua was gone and the elders died, there came a people. In verse 10 we can see. And also all the generations were gathered unto their fathers, and there arose another generation after them which knew not the Lord. After Joshua passed away and the elders that served with him, there rose up a generation that knew not the Lord. Yet the works which he had done for Israel, they didn't know. They hadn't seen it. And we live in a generation today that hasn't seen the glory of God through his people manifested. And God is calling us in this generation that doesn't know the Lord. In every nation, the nations of the earth have grown so far away from God. England just put in place their first Muslim mayor. Europe needs Jesus now. The United States of America needs Jesus now. And God is raising up a voice in his people. If we will hear, we can be those that raise up like the Deborahs, like the Gideons, just out there determined that he was going to hide out somewhere and get some food harvested for his family. Where other people were afraid to move, Gideon went and hid behind the threshing floor and was getting food for his family. And the angel of the Lord shows up and says, "By my, you mighty man of valor." He's like, "Who, me? What? I'm over here hiding the kid food." Oh. Just tired of the enemy running over everything. People that are willing to just take a hold of what God's done and rise up and say, "Here I am, Lord." Yes. I mean, Gideon, he may have put out fleeces and did all kinds of stuff, but he got up and he went with 300 men, and there were thousands to one against them. They had a big army, but God said, "Send them home, because I'm going to just choose 300 valiant men to go and take care of it, so I can show you that it's not you. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by the Spirit of the Lord. It's the Lord God Almighty that is doing the work." Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. It is the Lord God Almighty that has done the work in you. And he's completed the work in you. And it is finished. And like I said this morning, as I heard the Spirit say, "I've given you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven." When I was talking to the Lord and he said that to me, when I heard him say that in a way that I had never heard it before, he said, Jesus said, I go to the Father. I'll send the Holy Spirit and I'm turning the ministry over to you. I'm turning the work over to you. Here it is. To Peter, James, and John, and Thomas, "I won't believe unless I thrust my hand into his side." And Jesus is saying, "Thomas, here, you're going to go for me. You're going to go for me, Thomas. Here you go. I give you the work that I started, and I'm sending you the Holy Ghost. Go wait for that promise. And continue on my work." Amazing. You must not be getting that. Because he said it to you. Yeah. has left us with His work to do. What Jesus started, He said, you go continue. My God, that is just overwhelming to me. That He would entrust us. Oh, Jesus. I can't even hardly think about John chapter 17 without rapturing now. That they may be one. We won't read the whole chapter, I don't think, tonight, but I'm gonna go over here because this is overwhelming. That chapter. And you know, for those that weren't here this morning, man, that Jesus, you would just want to get raptured up in this. In looking at the love of God right here. Because He's talking to those disciples. He's talking to those disciples that He just said to, every one of you are getting ready to leave me, forsake me, you're going to run. And of course, Peter, you know, he stands up and he says, not me. I'll die with you. And Jesus says, Peter, Satan has desired to sift you, but I've prayed for you. You know, in John chapter 17, says He prayed for me too. If He prayed for Peter and Peter made it, guess what? It says in verse 20, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on them through their on me through their word. He prayed for me. Because I believed on Him through their word. It may be a long after their word, but He prayed the prayer for me and you. And it worked for Peter, didn't it? God loves me so much. He loves you so much. He just wants you to take a hold of that. He wants you to take a hold of the love that He has for you. This everlasting love. But anyway, and the glory. No, verse 21, that they all may be one, as Thou, Father, art in me, and I am in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that You have sent me, that they may be one, the love of God. I mean, how would have we responded to our 12 disciples? We totally know every one of you are going to forsake me. Peter, you're going to deny me 3 times before the rooster crows. Even cuss. And just try to really make yourself look like, no, you had nothing to do with me. Denied Him. He said, I do not know Him. And Jesus said, as soon as you're converted, He prayed for him. He said, I prayed for you. And as soon as you got it straightened out, Peter, go and preach. Go preach. Repent and get up and go preach. And then he prays his prayer for all those guys that are going to forsake him. He prays his prayer. I don't know that we would pray that prayer. I don't think most of us would. Because we haven't comprehended the love. Man, when people do bad stuff to us, really bad stuff to us, really bad stuff to us, even not so bad stuff to us, they just say something about us.
Come on.
And we find out they say something about us. And we're all puffed up and offended. For how long? Yeah. But Jesus said, over here in verse 8, I know I'm skipping back over, but I just can't help it. I mean, this is good. There were some people that weren't here this morning, and I guess the Holy Spirit is just wanting to catch you up. You can go back and you can look at the YouTube too. And we'll go to verse 6. I have manifested your name unto the men which you've gave me out of this world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Peter, Thomas, the one that, you know, Jesus appeared to Mary, and he's like, don't believe you. I mean, they're hiding out because they were like, if people recognize us, we are toast. We are toast, people. Now what are we going to do? And Mary comes running in. I've seen the Lord. And they're like, she's crazy. This isn't just the day that Jesus was crucified. This is all the way till he's resurrected. We got 3 days here. They left him in the garden before he died. We got over 3 days here. And they're just going, they're all wrapped up in them. It's all about them. And they're like, she's crazy. And, and Thomas comes up with that famous line, I won't believe unless I thrust my hand into his side. But that was after Peter and John went to the sepulcher and they saw. And then, Jesus appears to two of them as they're walking along and they said, haven't you heard what's been done? And we thought he was the one and we thought that he was going to be. But you know what? They thought he was going to do it his way. We always think God's going to do it our way, don't we? Ooh, he don't. He does it his way. And he didn't say, I'll come follow you. He said, you come follow me. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, Father. He's so amazing. He's talking about people that we would say, you're just a bunch of renegades. Why did he even pick you guys? Because you're all going to just run. Nobody's staying with me. I got to do this alone. He gave them a key, though. And this is a key that you want to take a hold of. He gave them a key in the garden. He said, watch and pray so you do not enter into temptation. The spirit is always willing, but man's ability is very weak. Guys, you should have got that under the law. Man can never obtain to God. You can never do it. You can only receive what he has done. He has done it, and it's finished, and he's called us over here to be one with him. He just did it for us because he's so good. Because he's so good. He's made us holy. The blood of Jesus Christ did the finished work, made us holy, unblameable, unreprovable in his sight. He did it. We don't take a hold of that, we keep helping. I know, because I live around people all the time. And if we can just take a hold of that, it is a finished work in us. He's given it all. He's given everything to us. And he just wants us to move out in him. But I tell you what, faith works by love. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. And the word of God is the love of God. It's the love letter to us. How much I loved you. Faith, everything works. The deal is we have it all, but it works by love. And that's the only way it's going to work. We might have a little show up here and there, but I don't know anybody that's doing greater works than Jesus did. Because we must be saturated in who he is. God is love. And taking a hold of that and I'm a new creation. Yes. Taking a hold of the love of God will bring you in to the comprehension of the new creation and who you are in Him. I'm going to read this real quick in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become brand new. The old man, we could go into Romans chapter 6. The old man has been crucified. We've been given the new creation, created in newness of life. So why the battle? Why do we continually battle? And why is there continually a fight? What's going on? Because you've got to notify the enemy. But first you must comprehend that that old man is dead. And you're over here in the new man. And that's not you. It's not you. I don't care what he brings your way. He can breathe all of his lies. All he wants to. And if you will not listen, if you'll say, that man's dead. He said, but you did, but you did, but you did. He's the accuser. I forgot I did that. I don't even remember it. Get out of here. I'm over here. That man's dead and buried, and you're not resurrecting him. That's not me. That's not who I am. Christ Jesus has made me a new creature. In him. That is not me. So he's yelling in your ear. Blah, 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 blah. You know how he does. Every one of you have dealt with it. Blah, 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 blah. And it's so loud. You're like, oh God, I must have problems. And you get down and you start repenting. Oh God, there's something. There's a generational curse. That's what it is. We got to break the generational curse. No, the devil's just a liar. That's not you. And when you notify him, you give him as many black eyes as you punch at, you know, whatever. Because he has no power, because he cannot come past the blood. The death angel could not go past the blood. When they put the blood of the lamb over the door, the death angel could not go and visit there. You've got the blood painted on you. The blood is painted on you. The enemy cannot trespass. You just got to tell him that that's not you. That you're over here in the new creation. Old things have passed away. All things are new. And all things in me now are of God, who has reconciled me to himself. This is why Jesus died, to bring relationship and fellowship and the glory of heaven for you right now here today. I was raised listening to those songs about if we can just get to heaven, oh, this miserable life and how horrible it is. I can't even remember the songs because I don't want to remember them. But that's how they were. And this life was just going to be so hard and so miserable. That's not what the Word of God says. I don't know what they were reading when they wrote those songs. But they were going by man's experience. So many people get up and they preach man's experience and they don't preach the Word of God. He reconciled us to the Father. And when we have fellowship and relationship with Father, that's heaven in earth. That's His kingdom come. His will be done in this earth right here. In this earth. And you know, when it's done in this earth, then we can manifest it like Jesus manifested it to us. When His will is done in this earth, then His glory is manifested to the earth. Amen. Oh, Jesus. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, God, you're so good. Oh, thank you, Father. Reconciled us unto Himself by Christ Jesus. And has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Oh, I like that. He's reconciled us to Himself. And now we can go to everyone and bring them reconciliation. He's given us. There it is. He says, continue on with my ministry. If you feel neglected and left out. Remember, God said, here. He didn't leave anybody out. He didn't say, there's only a few people that I'm going to give the keys of the kingdom of heaven to. And there's only a few people I'm going to give the authority and power to. And only a few people can bind what they want to on earth and to be bound in heaven. And only a few people can loose on earth and it be loosed in heaven. He said everyone. Amen. Not one of you are left out. Amen. And if God's not left you out, who cares what anybody else does? Stop seeking the approval of people. Amen. Stop looking at what people do and how they treat you. Look at how God treats you. He loves you, and let that overcome you so you can live in this glory and not in the circumstances of earth. People live by experience, and then they preach experience, and then they sing experience, and it has nothing to do with the Word of God, because living in His presence and in this reconciliation with Him is glorious. It is glorious. Oh, what glory, divine. His presence. In His presence is fullness of joy. At His right hand are pleasures forevermore. It is His good pleasure to give you the kingdom. I've come that your joy might be fulfilled. Fulfilled. I didn't come for you to live in sadness and sorrow, He said. He didn't say that. And then Christians, no wonder people don't want to be a Christian. People that go to church and are saying they're Christians, they look like the most miserable people on the planet. That is what religion will do for you. Religion will make you ugly. Relationship, reconciliation with the Father will make you beautiful. And people will go, what do you got? Why are you smiling? Why do you have that glow on your face? What is it about you that's different? I like it. They just need to see the love of God. They just need to know that God first loved them so they can receive that so they can love Him. Jesus. But we do it like John Luke said it when I was trying to teach him his memory verse the other day. I was teaching him, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. And we went over it. And I said, now John Luke, repeat it back to me. And he said, this is my commandment, that you love as people love you. I said, uh-huh. I just laughed. I'm like, that's exactly how they do it, John Luke. That's exactly how it is. If people love you enough, you'll let them in your circle. But if they don't do it right, they ain't getting in your circle. Uh-uh. Because you are going to protect yourself, and you're not going to let no hurt in, and you ain't messing with that stuff. And you can call it whatever you want. You can even put religion all over it and say, you know, you got to get these things right before you can come hang out with me. What? Jesus hung out with the ugly people because He had life to bring them. Jesus came in the room and light came on. He manifested the glory of the Father to the common people. Amen. He manifested the glory of God to you. Isn't He good?
Yes.
To you.
Yes.
Boy, did you deserve that. No. No. So I helped him get it right. You know, my grandkids, I've got a thing with them that they learn so many scriptures. They learn scriptures, and every scripture they learn, they get money. And you go, you give them money for learning scriptures? And like, well, the Lord rewards us. He's the rewarder of them that diligently seek us. Seek Him. He's the rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. He will reward you if you diligently seek Him. They diligently are learning these verses because they know there's a reward. Amen. I'm going to get the Word of God hidden in their heart one way or the other.
Hallelujah.
And if money works, and Elijah lives next door to me, so he really gets to benefit. He goes home and he's working on one, and he's like, I got another one, Nani. I got another one. I got another one. And here he comes for his money. His bank is going to blow up. But that's good. And then I got him a Bible. And then I gave him markers. And I said, now go mark every scripture you've learned. I got him a real one because he's going to be almost six now. So he's over there just reading the word and looking for another scripture so he can get it in his heart and go back to Nani. I tell you, it's going to be amazing what God does with all that word that they're building up. I'm excited about it. I'm looking at the potential God has in them and in you. I see God. I see God and what He wants to do through you. Not where you're at, but His goodness on you. And that's what God sees. That's what Jesus saw in John chapter 17. Jesus saw the work that He had done. And He said, they've believed. They ain't going to look like it for a little bit. But they've believed. And they know that I was sent from you, Father. I'm amazed. Any of us would have thrown them all away. Just be real. I want that love. I want the love of God manifested in me.
Yes.
Jesus was praying for them. And He prayed for us. The Almighty God prayed. He took the time to pray for us. Can we be like Him and take the time to pray for other people that are in need? That haven't experienced that love, or maybe have experienced that love and can't see right now? Oh, Jesus. Jesus. To the wit that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto Himself. This is what God's doing. We're like taking, you guys take a hike, and God's reconciling the world to Himself. Not imputing their trespasses unto them, and has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. And now, then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray, you Christ, in Christ's stead, be reconciled unto God. For He hath made Him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. Who are you? When the enemy comes out against you, trying to beat you up, who are you?
The righteousness of God in Him.
So what are you going to do next time the enemy is trying to convince you that you're a loser? I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I'm seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, and from there I will talk to you.
Amen.
Not high above the people that God loves, but high above all the powers of darkness and the imps of hell. With authority. Seated in Christ Jesus. He's sitting by Papa, making intercession for us, and we're in Him, and He's in the Father. And from that place, we're going. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I don't care what you say about me. That was me, but I'm under the blood. The blood is painted. You see the blood. When you see the blood, you got to pass over me. Because the Word of God says, you cannot touch me with your slimy sin. You were sometimes in the past in darkness. 1 Corinthians, right over here. Let's look at that. Got the fan over here helping me lose pages here. Look at that. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Know you not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, or adulterers, or effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. Look at verse 11. And such were some of you. Were. Past tense. Were some of you. Somewhere up here it's got to be religious and haughty and high-minded and prideful. It's in there. Goody two-shoes. But such were some of you. But you humbled yourself under the mighty hand of God. And he lifted you up. The religious people, man, that are raised up in religion, they're some of the hardest ones. Jesus. But that's okay. God loves them. We had the Nicodemuses and the Jairuses. Jairus, a ruler of the synagogue, he gets in need. And he's like, I've seen him. I've seen the glory. And my little girl's dying. And I don't care what it costs me. I don't care if they kick me out. I'm going where the glory is. Because what I see in him is everything I've read in the Old Testament, in the Torah. This is what I've read, and this is what I know in God. And he's manifesting God. And my little girl's dying, and I ain't chancing it. I'm going after the master. And his faith got built up so much that he believes so much that he went running after him. And he humbled himself before the Almighty. And Jesus rose that little girl right up. The goodness of God. He didn't go, now say you're a ruler of the synagogue, huh? Mm-hmm. And were you siding with those guys when they were speaking out against me? Did I see you, Jairus, in that crowd? Now, buddy, you're going to have to do some stuff. Straighten it out. My God, he's so good. Yeah. He's so good. Yeah. He's so good. Yeah. And such were some of you, but you are washed. But now you're sanctified. You're set apart for the Master, for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Now you're sanctified. You are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus. By the Spirit of our God. That's who you are. That's who you are. So now, from this place of position, seated in Christ Jesus in heavenly places, we're not here on earth. We're in the earth, but we're not of the earth. So in our spiritual man, we're seated in the heavenly places with Christ right now. We're not going up into that realm of heaven someday. We're already there. Yes, we see through a glass darkly, but then we will see face to face. Yes, we know in part, but then we will have it all unveiled to us. But right now, we're still seated in heavenly places with him. Amen. In him. Yes. Not just with him. We're not beside him. We're in him. I love that. I was looking at that in. I kept looking at that two-letter word, in. In him. In him. I'm in him! And he's in me. And then you start getting a hold of his seed remains in you and you cannot sin. You can't go over there. You can't. The blood's painted all over you. You can't step across that because he's in you. Oh, Jesus. Oh, God, you're so good. You're so amazing that you love us so much. To treat us like that. The love of the Father. The love that he's put in us to live out. And we run busily right over top of it. And we don't allow that love to manifest through us. And I'm going to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I tell you what, his word's so eternal. I have read this, and at one time I memorized the whole chapter. And I've read it and read it, and there was a song that was sung, so many songs about this chapter. But I gaze at this chapter, and I'm like, this is God. This is who he is. He's love. And he's spelling it out for us. This is so powerful. Though I speak with tongues of men and of angels. So you can know right there that in the gift of tongues, there's the tongues of the nations of the earth, and there's the heaven tongues of angels. So if people want an explanation, you can start right there. Though I speak with tongues of men and of angels, and I have not love, I am become as a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. It doesn't matter if I'm not yielding to the love that the Holy Ghost has put in my heart. It doesn't matter if I'm not yielding to who God is in me. He is love. God is love. That's who God is. You want to know who God is? He says he's love. He may be known by Jehovah Jireh and all of the names for him, but he so reveals himself as the God of love. God is love. That's who he is. He's love. Amazing love. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries, I have the gift of prophecy, I understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have faith so I can remove mountains. That sounds like some pretty radical people, right? We'd be looking at them and going, whoo, those guys are radical. And I have not love, I am nothing. I might look like a big deal to men, but to God, I'm nothing. What's important to me is who I am to the Father. Yes. Above all things, to manifest his love. And first, receive it. Because when people continually feel separation from God, it's because they're not receiving his love. Because perfect love casts out all fear. And when you don't have this confidence in God, it's because you haven't received that love. And a lot of the times, it's because you compare it to what happened to you in this earth, to the rejection you felt as a child, a lack of your father's love, a lack of love from people, continual abuse and being cast down from people, people beating you with their tongues, or maybe physically hitting you. But I tell you what, the tongue beating, that's something Brother Yun said when he came the first time. He said, the beatings that I took in China physically, you could comprehend them. But when I came to the West and people began to beat me with their words, people that were in the church, he goes, it was a place I didn't comprehend. It was so outside of anything I experienced, and it was very painful. But when we're dead and we're buried with Christ, when we're dead and we're buried and we're raised up together with him, we can learn to step aside and realize that it's not us. That is something. We were in a ministry one time, my father's ministry, right in the crucial ages of those teenage years, the 13, 14, 15, 16. Those years right there are so important that you really, really showing your kids the love of God. You're ministering to them the love of God. Every part of their life is very important, but those are crucial years right there. Those are very decisive years. And people in the ministry turned against my father, people that he had done so much for. My mother had laid her life down for them, just went beyond. You know, like Paul said, You know, there was one point that you would have given your eyes for me. You'd have plucked out your own eyes for me. And so we're experiencing this. And, you know, so these people, I'm a teenager, so they're my friends. And I think, you know, best friends. And I don't know why I'm telling this story, but I'm going to go ahead. And so at one point, we went out as a family. It was just the three of us younger kids, or the four of us younger kids left. The two older ones weren't with us at that point. My oldest sister, Winona, and Mark. And we went out on an evangelistic trip because my father first is an evangelist. And we went and we did ministry and we came back a couple of months later. And to understand this, my mother, in our house, we had a big house, and my mother would cook for all the guys that had gotten saved. And so she'd cook breakfast, lunch, and she'd get up early in the morning before they went to work, and at 5 o'clock she'd have breakfast on the table for them. You're talking about a servant. I don't know that I could have ever done that. But I mean, my mom loved people. My mom was a good woman. She wore herself out for the kingdom, and she's in her eternal reward having a very good time. Yes. And so we come back, and, you know, we've been on the road for 6 weeks, 8 weeks, something like that, and we come back, and we walk in the kitchen, you know, we're just going to get refreshed, and we're met at the kitchen going, go out. The kitchen's closed. And I'm like, I think I'm 15 at this point, and I'm like, excuse me? My mom and dad are just standing there. They're not saying anything. It's quiet. And I'm like, whose kitchen is this? It's new rules. You're going to have to learn to abide by them. The kitchen is closed. And I'm like, my mom and dad are just standing there. And my mom had walked over to the cabinet, was opening the cabinet because she was going to get something out. And they're closing the cabinet and not allowing her to open the cabinet in her kitchen. They just came into our house while we're gone, and they set up new rules. So I grew up in this, you know, seeing things like this. And so I don't think I've even ever told this to my children. And so here I am, 15. My dad's there. My mom's there. And I'm the one that's got all the knowledge. Two of my closest friends were standing there, a guy and a girl and some other people. They're standing there telling us this. And parents are quiet. And they're shutting the cabinet door on my mom. And I said, if you mess with my mom, I'm going to lay you out on this floor. That's the love of God I perceived right then. I'm 15. They're all bigger than me. They all weighed a lot more than me because I was about a whole 105 pounds. And I said, I'm going to lay you out on this floor. Everybody scattered. They just left. I'm like, wow, Dad must have been standing beside me and go, I'm on back up. No. He wasn't. And things went on and continued on like that. A lot of stuff happened. People that I loved, and I couldn't get it. I love these people. They were my friends. I couldn't get it. Why would they do this to us? My dad and my mom had laid down their life for them. Because of my father, they were saved. Because my family gave and gave and gave so much, and we shared everything that we had. They're here. And why is this happening? How could this be? And I said to Dad, Dad, you don't say a word. You don't defend yourself. You don't do anything. You're so good to them. You're kind. You're kind in return to them. How can you do this? He said, Geneva, they're not doing it to me. I step aside. They're doing it to Jesus. He's the one that takes care of it. And I was like, I didn't get it. I wanted to get it. I saw him really have it. And I saw the love of God on him. And I saw it so amazing. But I was hurt because these were my friends. And I'm only 15 and I can't comprehend this love of God. I haven't gotten it. I know that I'm in Him and I love Him and He loves me and I'm born again and I'm washed in the blood and I'm going to heaven, but I can't comprehend this. And so then I went on a time of just like people would try to get close to me and I would just go, nope, that means hurt. That means they're just going to turn on you. And people would try to befriend me, and I'd let them only so far. Never was I going to take somebody into my heart and love them like that again. Trust them like that again. But I wouldn't say, that's not what I said. But that's what I was doing. But I tell you what, those words that my Father spoke to me that day by the Spirit of the Lord, Geneva, I step aside because it's not, they're not doing it unto me. They're doing it to Him. Became words that formed me. And I took a hold of the love of God and I'm taking a hold of it more. But those words formed me and I was able to release and forgive everyone. And I had to learn to love again, because it'd be the most spiritual people, so-called, would be the most, the ones that would wound the worst. And so, boy, when somebody was spiritual, I was like, really? And my mom and dad went on loving. Amazing. So I had some hard bumps there, but God was there with me while I wasn't getting it. He was there. And He used those things to form me and to teach me. Because I tell you, I went by some of my own ability. And I'm like, but you're my friend, why? But you're my friend, why? But you're my friend, why? And I tried to, you know, I wanted to bring them back, but then I didn't want to bring them back. But yet, you know, I had established this relationship and they were my family. I might not hug on you all the time, because I'm not a super huggy person. I remind myself to hug my grandkids. I'm sorry, you know, the Lord's working, He works on all of us like that. And I love my grandkids, I love my kids. I don't hug my kids every time I see them. But, you know, I love them. And I want to hug them. I just have to hug the grandkids. It is not that I don't love you, because, you know, sometimes people get offended because you don't just run up and hug them every time. And I'm sorry, I'm gonna get there. Thank you, Jesus. I mean, you know, it's just they're different personalities for different reasons. But anyway, I don't know how I got off on that. But anyway, I love you, every one of you. You are my family. And I cherish you, and it's so important to me to see every one of you, and even those that aren't even here tonight, even those that haven't been here for years, to see them in the kingdom of heaven. I tell you what, I don't let go of the people that have left here. I still have fellowship and friendship with so many of them. Because God loves them. And He loves every one of us. Sometimes there's a lot to do and you can't keep up too much, but we want to love like God loves. Oh, Jesus, You're so good. You're so amazing. And though I bestow all of my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and I have not love. Wait a minute. I gave everything away. Didn't Jesus say to the rich young ruler, just give it all to the poor and then come follow me? So I gave it all away, and I gave my body to be burned. But I didn't have love. I mean, that's radical. You think you're making brownie points with God? You're not with what you do. You're not. Because it's out of the heart that God looks at. It's the way you do it from the heart. It's the way you love from the heart. Man, this is good. This is good. Whew. How much He loves us, and He's poured into us so we can live out Him. And He's just saying, He's just simply saying, I love you, and all the work you can do and all you can muster up doesn't matter. I've done the work in you. Now just receive and yield to my love. That's what I want you to do. I want you to be like God. God is love, your love. Get it? No, we don't. Because we don't manifest it. But we're going to get it because the revelation of the Father is here tonight. And we've been praying, oh God, make this go deep on the inside of us. I've been going after this. I was like trying to think of how many years I've been praying on, preaching on love. And I think I'm starting to get a little bit more. I've been studying this. I've been gazing upon it. I've been looking at it. I've preached it. And then I hear the Father speaking it. And I'm like, oh, Jesus. You know, there's times I go, oh, God, am I even saved? And it's not that. It's just that the truth sets you free. Amen. And when you receive the truth, the lie is expelled. Yeah. And it's not that you're not washed in the blood and you're not going to heaven. It's just that you haven't come to the place to comprehend, but you're going to grow in this. You're going to grow up in the love of God. This is how to be fully mature. There's so many scriptures that we can go to right now. They're probably exploding on the inside of Stuart. He knows every one of them where to turn to. You're going to grow up in the love of God. And this is what brings you into that place where you'll never fall or stumble. Jesus. Love suffers long. We give it about 2 seconds. And the more we think about it, you really made me mad. You touched God's anointed. No, I'm not saying, I'm talking about, you know, I'm not saying that because there's a place of authority in it, and I'm not making light of that at all. But I'm saying to each other. You know, we take, you know, those places. Love suffers long. There's a place that you don't, things you don't do. You honor those that are over you in the Lord. I don't want anybody to think I'm saying that because I'm not. But I was just saying, I was actually thinking about husband and wife. Now you've touched God's anointed. You know what? It takes two people to argue. So if you have arguments, there's two people arguing. Because when you won't argue, there's not an argument. When you won't have a disagreement, there's none. There's not a disagreement. It's amazing, isn't it? Love suffers long, and it's kind. Kind. Brotherly kindness. See, that's in Peter, 2 Peter chapter 1. Brotherly kindness. Add to, let's see, what is that? Add to your faith, virtue, and virtue, temperance, and, you know, I know these, but I'm kind of like, add to your faith, virtue, virtue, knowledge, knowledge, temperance, 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 patience, patience, godliness. Brotherly kindness is coming, but there's more than brotherly kindness. To godliness, brotherly kindness, and brotherly kindness, love. And look at that. If you do these things, you shall never stumble. You shall never fall. So anyway, we get to stay over here because I remembered. Love suffers long. I know I read that. And is kind. Kind. What is kind? What is kind? And is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not vaunt itself. And it's not puffed up. That means it's humble. Not down here going, oh, poor me.
but up here in Christ Jesus and from that place of authority, being like God. Doth not behave itself unseemly, seeks not her own, is not easily provoked, seeks not her own. Seeks not her own? Seeks not her own? That's what we live in. Is I need, 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 I need. And when I get up in the morning, please have this ready and do this, and I got to get in, and I need, and I need, and I need, and I need, and I need. And our life is about I need. Be honest. And God's saying, take no thought. And I take thought. I want a bowl, and when I wake up in the morning, I like to have a bowl with some strawberries and blueberries and, you know, throw in a good juicy navel orange and then have me some pecans on the side, little granola or whatever. You know, taking a lot of thought right there, huh? We kind of get caught up in me. Well, who else is going to take care of me? The Father. If we think about it, we really prepare for ourselves. Seeks not her own. Does not behave itself unseemly. That one, boy, really need to think about that. Seeks not her own. Is not easily provoked. Is not easily provoked. You know, when we're squeezed and there's some pressure on, what comes out? I was saying, Lord, when I'm squeezed and you're working something out in me, all I want people to see is Jesus. All I want them to see is Jesus. Think about when you're squeezed. Lord, all I want you to see in me, if nobody else is around, all I want you to see is what you've done for me. Me captivated by what you've done for me. Thanks no evil. Thanks no evil. Not only thanks no evil in participating with evil, but thinks no evil of anyone. Doesn't think evil of other people. And I've used this illustration before, mostly in the women's meeting. But this happens to people all the time because I know I hear, I don't think anybody likes me, that type of thing. Thinks no evil. And, you know, this one time I'll use this illustration because these kind of things happen all the time. And people go, well, don't know what their problem was. Maybe not quite so that abrupt, but we think it up here in the ticker real nicely. But I'm just showing you how it really is. Well, see if I'll talk to her again. She's really going to have to get my attention if that's the way she's going to be. But so, anyway, I was walking up to a person, and they rushed by me, didn't acknowledge me, look at me. I was going to hug them or something. And they just walked up and went and sat down. And I'm like, okay. What did I do? And so I thought about it a minute. I'm like, so what could have I done? You know, I love that person. They know I love them. What did I do? What happened? Why were they rude to me just now? This is church, in church. So I thought about it a few minutes. I said, I know what. First opportunity I'm going to just totally expose this. This is a lie of the enemy. I know it. I'm just going to go up after church and hug them and just deal with it. If they've got a problem, we'll deal with it. If they don't got a problem, then I'll know. And so, done. I'm not thinking about this anymore. But, you know, I was a little bit offended in the beginning. And so, I beeline over to them after church. I'm like, I'm going to deal with this. Just get it all clear. Clear the air. And I went up to hug them, and they're like, oh, oh, thank you for coming to me. I wanted to talk to you. I've been going through some stuff, and I needed to talk to you, and the Lord just knew to send you over to me. I'm thinking, why didn't they see me before church? I was coming to them. But, no, I really didn't think that. But, you know, that was the whole thing. But then we create a scenario in our mind that's not even true. Again and again and again, every day. I'm not that person anymore. I'm not that person anymore. We got to put that up when the enemy wants to bring that to us and say, I am not that person anymore. That's not me. That's the old man. I don't think any evil of anybody. You're going to have to prove something's wrong with you for me to believe it. I mean, it's going to have to be so obvious. And then I'm going to love you anyway. I'm going to pray for you anyway. You hurt me, and Jesus is going to just love on you through me. Because that's what he does. Oh, glory. Woo, he's good. Thank you, Jesus. This may be slow and quiet and simple, but we need to get this. This morning might have been more exciting about him talking about how much he loved us. And now we're going over here and we're saying, this is who he is and this is what he wants of us. Yeah. And it doesn't seem quite as exciting right now because it might be stepping on our toes a little bit. But I tell you, it's not. It's good. Yes. It's so good. Yes. It's so good. Yes. God is so good. Rejoice is not an iniquity. They deserved it. Got that one? I knew something was gonna. Rejoice is not in iniquity, but rejoice is in the truth. Thy word is truth. And oh, how he loves me. He loves me so much, he died for me, and then he reconciled me with the Father. And then he made me righteous. Amen. And you taking a hold of that, you put your hand up when the enemy comes and starts trying to convince you that you've got a generational curse. Because you ain't able to break this thing and it keeps coming at you and it's yelling so loud in your mind. Because the enemy wants to convince you. It's the accuser of the brethren. He wants to convince you that you're his and you're not. You've got the blood on your doorpost. Maybe we need to take red markers for a little bit. So, I mean, we can see it. Oh, Jesus. God, you're good. We don't want to be like the people from India. I mean, that's bad. But anyway, just the devil trying to copy Jesus and it didn't work. That's a curse right there. That's invoking evil spirits. And people play around, put that thing on their head, like dressing up. And that's invoking evil spirits. That's what that is. Anyway, you can go look that up. Bears all things. Bears some things. Just some. All things. You know what? This is what God has done on the inside of us. He's given us this love to bear all things. To bear all things. To believe all things. It hopes in all things. Endures all things. You know, believe all things. That's one thing with my children. I never talk to my children down. I know people that talk their children down and they say mean things to their children. You should never say mean things to your children. You should never tell them how bad they are. You should tell them who they are in God and that they're coming to know this and that they need to catch up with it because there might have to be some discipline if you don't catch up with this, you know. But don't talk them down. These things are wrong. We can't do them. We don't want to do them. This is not who God's made you. You need to tell the enemy, no, that's not who you are. But don't talk your kids down. I never talk to my kids down. If one of them would say, he lied, don't you ever call each other a liar, because the devil is the liar. And I would never, ever participate in calling one of my children a liar. I don't want to call anybody a liar. I want to say, the enemy has come out against you. Now let's deal with this thing and have no part of it. You don't want to beat anybody down with your words. You don't want to beat people around you or your children. You want to speak the eternal purposes of God over them. You want to speak the truth over them, the word of God over them. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God, you're good. He's good. That's what he's speaking over us. Do we deserve his righteousness to be imparted in us? Do we deserve to be holy, unblameable, unreprovable in his sight? No. But we are. When we receive the blood and we receive the reconciliation. It's not about Jesus coming so you can say a little prayer and you could go to heaven. It's about Jesus coming and reconciling you to the Father and you getting captivated by the love of God. You coming over into fellowship with the Father so you just like get up in the morning and go, I don't want to live to myself. Where's that cross? Whoa, Father, I'm following you today. Because you're good. Oh, God, you're so good to me. Before I get up in the morning, I'm usually crying about how good he is. Captivated by his love, because I reach out to him and he touches me with his glory, and I get captivated over in the glory. And so then the day is about him and not about me. It's about taking up my cross and following him, and I can look like the glory of God. If I miss that, then I miss him. Jesus, this is so good, and he just wants us to be partakers of this now. The truth will set you free so you don't have to walk in you anymore, but you can live over here in the love of God. And you can stop looking at your ability to give all your goods to feed the poor and to give your body to be burned. You can stop looking at what you can do to come to God, and you can realize and see that he's already done it in you. That love is already in you. And you want to manifest his love, not what you can do. Not to do good, not human compassion, not humanity, but God. On the inside of you. God living out his love on the inside of you. His love. And it's ours. It's all ours. And it's the greatest of all gifts. Because it's who he is. And we want to take a hold of that. That communion of him bringing us in. And praying for those rotten, miserable 12 disciples that are all going to forsake him and say, Father, that they may be one as I'm in you and you're in me, that they may be in me and in us. That's how we want to pray for people. When people mess up and they do it wrong, we want to hit our face and cry out to God for them and love them. We want to some more love on them and say, just receive the love of God. We want the more to bring them in and care about them. Jesus. It hopes all things. It endures all things. Love never fails. It's not a selfish love of two people getting married. And so many times, because of what our society has set up, the girls, they start in Cinderella about 5 years old and maybe even before. And they're all caught up. And they've got this big air castle in the sky already built up in their mind by the time they're 12. And one day, their knight in shining armor is going to come riding up on this great horse. And he's going to sweep them away. And the guy don't have a clue about this. Not a clue. He don't care about that stuff. He ain't thinking about that stuff. He don't care about the knight in shining armor. He don't care about the white horse. He don't care about the castle. None of it. But she's got this dream. And she finds a poor victim. And And she pours all of this dream on him. And he's the one. He's the knight in shining armor. He don't have a clue he's a victim. But she's a victim too. Because it's all about to him. About self-gratification. Oh, good. A wife. A woman. Oh, God said he that finds a wife finds a good thing. Like that. Breakfast in the morning, lunch packed for me for my lunchtime, dinner on the table when I come home, my clothes washed. I ain't got to wash those clothes anymore. House clean, I come in, I prop my feet up, and I watch TV. So we got two different perspectives going on here. He sees her as a slave, and she sees him as a knight in shining armor that's going to come and rescue her from all of her problems. And the reality strikes. They have the fairy tale wedding. They go down the aisle. They do all of these things. She's like, He's like, what's for breakfast? Nothing to do with love. Because love is all about what can I give and what can I do for you? Because see, that's God. God so loved, he gave. It's about what can I do for you? How can I serve you? How can I bless you? How can I be a blessing to you? But this is the reality of what goes on. A lot of them end in divorce. A lot of them are just like, he doesn't love me. I don't think he loves me the way he treats me. He doesn't treat me like a princess. They don't say princess. They wouldn't say princess. But that's what they think. Yeah, I don't think he loves me. She's like, he's like, hello, where is breakfast? I'm having to get up and cook breakfast myself because you know what? If they stick it out past the first year, all of a sudden, wah, wah! And they're hearing it all night, and they're just like, pillow over the head. This isn't what I was thinking. Air castle's got a huge nail put in it. Popped. There's no castle. There's no white horse. There's no knight in shining armor. And I'm not getting breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I come home, and the house is a mess. And the baby's screaming again. This isn't what I bargained for. You know why? Because you were all selfish. And you weren't thinking about serving and laying down your life. And being a priest of a home. Or being a woman of God, a Proverbs 31 woman. Well, that one hurts when you're thinking of an air castle. But this is reality. And if people went into a relationship like this and they let God bring someone together with them that would be the one that they could lay down their life for and share ministry with, there wouldn't be so much divorce. Because it would be totally different. It'd be all about serving. If you went in to a relationship with 1 Corinthians chapter 13, I'm having fun. It's good. God is good all the time. You know what? This morning, his son came up over me. And the worst, ugliest, most miserable person on the planet that hates him because he's good. He says, be like your father, which is in heaven. I cause my son to shine on the good and on the evil. I cause it to rain on the just and the unjust. Be like me. Bless. 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 I remind myself all the time, I want the blessing of God. So therefore, I'm going to speak a blessing. If somebody curses me, I'm going to render a blessing. If somebody's mad at me, how can I bless you? What can I do for you? Let me give you something. I literally ran as fast as I could when I knew somebody was upset. What can I bless them with? I'm going to go bless them. Because I want them, not because I want them to think I'm good, but I want them to see the love of God.
Amen.
That's why. That is why. I want them to connect to the love of God. I don't want them to think, oh, she's the sweetest lady I've ever met. No. I want them to connect to the love of God that never ceases.
Yeah. Amen.
That is that mercy that is new every morning.
Yes.
The goodness. And it's Jesus you see in me. Because if you see something good, it's because that's what he did. Because me, I was that 15-year-old girl. You touch my mama and I'll lay you out on that floor. And I was a quiet, shy person, but I knew these people. They were supposed to be my closest friends. And they done was messing with my mama. That comes from the South, you know, place where we lived in the South, that messing with, you know. Anyway, that accent, it rises up every once in a while. But anyway, thank you, Jesus. But we want people to see the goodness of God.
Yeah.
That is what we live for.
Yeah.
That's what we're to do. Not get all up in ourselves and offended.
Yeah.
But to show forth his goodness.
Amen.
To show how good he is.
Yeah.
You go over there and you look in Psalms 19 and you read that whole section where I think it's Psalms 163. It's 169 that I'm talking about. Great peace have they that love thy law. When we're raptured up in who he is and what he's done and that he's on the inside of us, nothing can disturb that peace. The waves can come. They can roar. The storm can come. It can look really bad. But I know in whom I believe. And I'm confident in him. And what is he going to do? And how is he going to work it out? Thank you, Jesus. I'm going after this in a deeper way than I ever have before. You know what? And there's testing that comes to get you there. There's testing that comes to take you all the way. Because God can use you more when you go all the way. So he's like, okay, I think they're ready. I think they're ready to get up a little bit closer. And I've played it out in my mind, okay, like this one's like an uphill thing right now. But we're going to climb this hill because when we get to the top, there's going to be more anointing. There's going to be an increase in the anointing. There's going to be an increase in the glory because that's God. When you feel like he's far away from you, people like they say that when you feel like, well, don't go, oh, God's far away from me. I can't get a prayer through. Start running after him. Father, Father, Father. It's not, what did I do and woe is me? Oh, God left me. No, he says, come over here. Run after me. Seek after me. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Whew. Love never fails. Never, not one time. He will never fail. As I started from the beginning, he will never break covenant with us. He will never leave and forsake us. He is love. He is going to run after us. He comes after us. He's standing there. And all of a sudden, we're just like, oh, God, where have you been? He goes, oh, I was right here. I was just waiting on you to come. And I mean, it's in an instant. In an instant. I mean, as soon as we breathe out his name. But there'll be a place in your life that you have to just go, I'm taking a hold of God.
Amen.
Jacob took a hold of God and he said, I'm not letting you go till you bless me.
Yeah.
There's a time in your life you got to take a hold of God.
Yeah.
And then it's just relationship, fellowship, and it just gets sweeter. And you're just like, Lord, how can I just be one moment out of prayer? Just one moment, because it's just too good. God, you're just so good. You pray. presence is so good. Father, you just love us so much. And he's got the answer for everything. We'll go and we'll try to manipulate what we think that might be going on now. And I perceive that God's doing something different. And okay, God, how are you going to work this out? We'll even kind of like try to fix it out. And God's like, what are they doing over there? And then we'd say, Father, what are you saying? And he's like, not that. None of that. That was you. Why don't you come over here and listen to me? Because right now we want to do something that looks like an easier path. Well, that path's not easier. It's not. It's never easier. People always think that the grass is greener on the other side. You watch cows. Okay, that's where that saying comes from. Anybody ever watch cows? Oh boy, people don't get grass is greener on the other side. Let me explain to you. Cows can be standing in clover all the way up. And they'll look across the fence and there'll be a couple of little sprigs of something. They're in clover that they can stand and chew on all day long. And across the fence, it's a little sprig of something because it's not watered. It's not irrigated. And they will skin themselves up trying to reach their neck through the wire, through the fence, to get over there to that sprig when they're standing in the clover the whole time. That is where the saying, the grass is not greener on the other side, came from. That's the understanding of it. Because everybody's trying to look for greener pastures. And a cow cannot comprehend with its brain that that's not greener pastures. And I tell you what, if you try to go across the fence, you will find that they are not greener pastures. Stay in the clover. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And let God do what he's doing. Because he's able. Thank you, Jesus. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail, and whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But thank God for the part, because it sure is good. But realize it's only part. It's only part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is part shall be done away with. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. When I was a child, I thought and I spoke as a child. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then we shall see face to face. Oh. And I tell you, what we do see is good. But I'm looking forward to beholding him more. And I'm planning on seeing him. I was talking to him about that the other day. I'm like, if Moses and the 70 elders of Israel could sit down with God and eat with him, and Jacob saw him, and Paul had a visitation, and he saw Jesus out of due season, then why can't I? I need to get more in the fight. I need to get more in somewhere and do something because I want more of a revelation of God. But I want to do it all in him. But I don't want to be like Reinhard Bonnke says, sitting on your couch. He said we can do all kinds of things with people, but we can't get them off their couch. God has all kinds of plans if you just get up off your couch and run with what he's done. And see, if you can't realize what he's done, you can't run with it. But if you take a hold of who you are, and the enemy's trespassing, that is not me, that's who I was, that is not me. We will never have another person come and go, I've got all these problems and I've got all these issues. No, you don't. That's not you, that's the devil lying to you. It's not you. That's why he says, put them to death. This is how you put them to death. No, that is not me. I don't do that anymore. Because I'm over here in the righteousness of God, and the righteousness of God cannot participate with that. I will not participate with that, because the righteousness of God cannot participate with that, and he's made me righteous, and he's made me holy, and he's giving power and authority over you. Hallelujah. And I'm not going to come under you again. So we should have no more defeat. Nobody else defeated in any way. Amen. Nobody else looking to yourself, looking inward, going, I think I was rebellious. I think I could have been rebellious. I could have been rebellious. Maybe I was rebellious. I'm a rebellious spirit. You just talked to the devil, is what you did. And he lied to you, and you believed it. Because he was shouting loud in your head. And so you had a conversation with him, and then you believed it, and you thought it was all you, and the conversation was all with you, and it was all how bad you are. I am seriously talking about what goes on. This is who you are. This is what you want. You want this. 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 Yes, oh God, I want it. Why do I want it? No! That is not who I am. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and I don't want that, and I have power over it. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, that you never break covenant with us. Father, that you will never leave us or forsake us, that you are there, right there in the midst of everything that's going on, and you give us power to stand against all the wiles of the devil and turn the army of the aliens to flight and turn the battle to the gate. Because you're so good, Father. He's not giving up on you. He's not giving up on you. He's not giving up on you. He will not give up on you. He's not giving up on you. He loves you. So stop listening to the lie and be more than a conqueror. I'm more than a conqueror. That's who I am. I'm more than a conqueror. That's who I am. Old things are passed away. I've been born again. The truth sets you free. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And he's in me. And I'm free. He who the Son sets free is free indeed. We're not held under the bondage of sin and death anymore. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. And God loves me. That's the thing. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Who loved me, who loved me, who loved me, who loved me, who loved me. People receive that he loves you. And then you have boldness and confidence. When people are empowered through what the Word of God says, when they grab the truth, the confidence and the boldness to come boldly into the throne room is there. And then they receive what the Father has by the Spirit. When people are encouraged, they're empowered. And God's encouraging you tonight because he wants you to be empowered. Because you're seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, and he wants you to know that. The enemy doesn't want you to know that. The Lord wants you to know that. He wants to encourage you tonight to know what he's done in you, that he has given you his ministry to carry on, because he trusts you. He trusts you because he put his Spirit in you, and he knows that by his Spirit and through Christ Jesus, you can do all things. If he believes in you, who else do you need to believe in you? He believes in you. He believes in you. Because he's in you. Not because of who you are, because of who he is in you and what he's done for you. He's entrusted you, and he says, come on. Come on. Be free. Hallelujah, Jesus. You, Father. Well, if anybody in this place needs prayer, we'll be glad to pray for you.
But I tell you, as the word goes forth, if we will receive it into ourselves, I mean, sometimes we need to write down signs, either write it down or get a picture made with it written on and put it up in our house and look at it continually. This is the way, and this is who he is in me. This is what he's done for me. Till we get it and we live it. And like I said this morning, I saw a week and a half ago on Wednesday night, I saw the clubs that people had in their hand beating themselves up continually. That's looking to yourself. That's looking to your ability. God's not beating you, but you've taken a club in your hand and you're your own worst enemy. The enemy may have had it and started beating you with it, but then you took it out of his hand and you started beating yourself. You said, give me that. Yeah, I'm in a low down scallywag. I'm a miserable mistake. Show me one place God said that about you. Show me one place God said about that about you. He did it. He never said that about you. He just said, I love you. I love you so much I sent my son so I could have fellowship with you. I want to have fellowship with you. Would you come have fellowship with me? Would you come live in me and let me live in you? I love you. It's more important for the Father to love you than anyone else. And then you're empowered even when it's hard. I just thought about what Martha shared with me the other day. It just hit me by the Spirit. She's talking about how she has preached the word and preached the word and preached the word and lived the life in front of all of her coworkers. And she's been persecuted and persecuted and made fun of and persecuted and made fun of. And there was times that it was just like, can I bear it? It's not easy to be persecuted. But just recently, someone called her up that had left the job a while back and called her up and said, Martha, I just want you to know I gave my life to Jesus. Martha, you were such a light to me. I saw Jesus in you. That's where I saw Jesus. I saw Jesus in you. I saw the love of God in you, and I want to thank you, Martha, for what you sowed into me. You didn't know you sowed it into me, but you sowed it into me, and now I have Jesus. That's happened so many times in our life, where years later, people call us up and said, I want you to know that all that you put into me wasn't a failure. I didn't receive it. I didn't like it then. I didn't want it then. But it impacted me. It went down on the inside of me. It impacted me, and I want you to know that I'm serving the Lord, and not only me, but my wife and my children are serving God. I mean, even 10, 20 years later, isn't God amazing? Yes. It may not look at what you're doing. You may not feel like what you're doing is enough, but you just keep sowing that seed liberally because that's what he called you to do. You just keep letting his love squeeze out of you. When you're squeezed, the love of God comes out. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Don't weary in well-doing. It's so exciting, man. Manny goes to the airport with my sister. He didn't tell me this. And he's supposed to be watching the car. And she turns around. He's got his hands on some lady praying for her. Radical. He didn't know her. He just saw her over at the airport. I don't even know the story. I just know he was over there praying for her when he was supposed to be in the car. He was about the Father's business. Thank you, Jesus. It's funny. She took him to the car, took him with her so she didn't get a ticket when they were dropping my dad off at the airport. But he was so captivated by the soul. And there's so many stories I think about that I've heard from so many people about the love of God. Cindy starts advertising an art project, art, so she can sew more because she wants to sew. So she's going to teach art, take some more of her time and teach art so she can sew the money into the Mission Training Center. And she's not telling anybody this, I am. So get over it. And she didn't even know I knew because I put pieces together. So she gets these Chinese kids in her art class. And then I don't know where their mom is tonight, but she starts coming to church. And she's like, ooh, the Holy Spirit's here. And she's driving from Chula Vista. And her church is right across the street. It's convenient, huh? And she's driving here. And I watch it. She stays late. She's one of the last ones to leave. And she tells her mom and her dad. And they come and they're like, I like the Holy Spirit. He's here. And then they tell their friend, which tells another friend. And they've all come to visit. And they were in the Tim Hall meetings. Because somebody wanted to sow more into the kingdom, and God says, I'm going to cause your righteousness to increase. Isn't that amazing what God will do with us?
Yeah.
And so many of you are probably exploding and can tell some kind of story, and really tonight I meant for people to be able to share. And I'm like, you know, when it got silent up here at one point when Joshua wasn't singing, I'm like, guys, there's chance. And I'm like thinking, go. You just get the microphone. You go up and you grab it. When the Lord's saying something to you, just be willing to move out. It may not be big. But like I said the other night at prayer, when I was like 12, 13 years old, the first thing that I got up and I said in a room full of young people, a few hundred people there, all of a sudden I felt it just bubble up out of me. And it was like, here the sun sets free. And somebody said before I could finish it, it's free indeed. And that's the truth. And it just come up out of me, and you're like, duh, that's what the Bible says. Well, we need to hear it.
Yeah.
That's prophecy. Because it's bringing forth the word in a power of revelation, and when God is speaking it through you, it is imparted. And it's glorious. And people get captivated when they receive the truth. It becomes alive and living. And it changes you forever. Father says, let me touch you. Receive the word and just let me touch you by my presence. Just receive from heaven and let it go deep. Church, be encouraged and be strengthened and be empowered. And know greater is he that's on the inside of you than he that's in the world. If there's anybody here that doesn't know the Lord Jesus as their Lord and Savior, we want to pray for you. If there's anybody here that hasn't experienced the love of God, we want to pray for you. If there's anybody here that has need of anything, we want to pray for you. And as you come, you can come and worship the Father with what he's given you, because he's so good. Thank you, Jesus.